But first, the U.S. is stepping up its campaign in Somalia against the terror group al-Shabab. But that fight will not be won unless U.S. allies like Kenya and others intensify their efforts. In January, there was a big setback to the mission when more than 100 Kenyan troops died on their base in Somalia, a result of al-Shabab's deadliest attack ever. Last week, the group released a video of the operation. Now, with the help of the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting, special correspondent Nick Schifrin looks at how al-Shabab is winning both on the ground and over the airwaves. A warning, some viewers may find images in this story disturbing.
It is 48 minutes of violence, video game graphics, and visions of victory. The video is pure propaganda, full of fancy editing and half-truths, but it's effective at portraying Shabab as strong and Kenya as weak.
What do you see when you watch this video?
The first thing that you notice is, number one, how many people they actually have moving against this defensive position.
Clint Watts is a former U.S. soldier and FBI investigator. He is now a Shabab expert.
It's a Kenyan force that's just getting annihilated here by what is a seemingly ragtag group that was put together on short notice. If you were with a competent force, just like you see here in this video with this vehicle running away, they should be able to stand right there and eliminate that entire force moving through the open.
It was the deadliest day in Kenyan military history. They were vulnerable not only because of poor defenses, but also because they haven't been on the offense.
Any troops that are out there just parked as sort of a occupy and hope that peace will come are always going to be vulnerable.
African Union troops pushed Shabab out of its strongholds 5 years ago. Since then, the troops have mostly remained in their bases. That's allowed Shabab to launch daily attacks and resurge.
That particular pause gave al-Shabab to regain his balance.
You bring up.
Kenyan Lieutenant Colonel Emmanuel Churcher was the chief spokesman against Shabab. In the Alade attack, he lost his brother, Dan.
I hear some people believe that when they die, they'll meet virgins. That's what al-Shabab believe. When Dan died, he met God.
Dan Churcher died instantly. His funeral was held with military honors. Shabab has attacked bases before, but never with a car bomb that exploded inside a base for African Union troops, known as Amazon.
It's a new experience, a new challenge that AMISOM forces are facing as a whole.
In response to Shabab's resurgence, the U.S. military has dramatically escalated its own attacks. In just the last 7 weeks, U.S. airstrikes and U.S.-backed ground assaults have killed at least 190 al-Shabab fighters, more than the total killed in the previous 9 years.
The Kenyans have taken a huge hit. You've got to somehow back them up and give them some reason to believe that they're going to be okay.
The U.S. now calls these attacks self-defense because they target Shabab fighters massing and presumably preparing for an attack. General David Rodriguez is the U.S.'s top soldier in Africa.
They disperse and attack and focus all that energy on one of the forward operation bases.
But the previous decades worth of American strikes couldn't prevent this horror. In fact, the al-Shabab brigade that carried out the attack is named after a Kenyan al-Shabab commander killed by a U.S. drone in 2009.
In Somalia, were you winning most of the battles?
This man, whom we granted anonymity, is a former member of the same unit. He says al-Shabab would be losing if African forces were more aggressive.
Most of the time, we would look at the enemy's strength and leave. If a town was taken from us, it was tough to retake it, since they had aerial support.
Which is why the U.S. is pushing and training African troops to attack more.
So it becomes a kind of competition, ensuring that you are ahead of the enemy. And if you're ahead of the enemy, of course, you reduce any kind of threat.
The video's threat is also as a recruitment tool to lure susceptible young men.
You can watch this as a potential recruit and be like, I am going to be this guy on the battlefield. This is something that excites me, and I'm with my brothers out here. And it's violent, and they're successful, so I want to be part of a winning effort.
Did you like the feeling of fighting with al-Shabab against the African forces?
It was good. We were like brothers. In the beginning, my morale was high.
Shabab reinforces that by forcing Kenyan soldiers to portray themselves as the losers.
We were attacked and overrun by the Muslim. They have defeated us.
In response, the African Union released its own video showing the Alade village recaptured.
AMISOM is not a peacekeeping mission. AMISOM is a war-fighting mission. So from deployment, you know you've come to fight.
But Shabab uses that same video to mock Kenya's public relations attempts.
So from deployment, you know you've come to fight. You know you've come to fight.
We will fight them deep in their hideouts.
Pointing out Kenya's refusal, even to this day, to release a death toll. Even Kenyans who support the troops make the same exact critique.
Right now what you have is propaganda from al-Shabab. And all you need is the truth from the government.
Boniface Mwange is an anti-corruption campaigner. He held a vigil for the Alade victims, but criticized the government for withholding details about how they died.
We celebrate the people who died and asking the generals and the commander-in-chief what really happened in Somalia. Tell us the truth.
As long as Kenya declines to tell its side of the story, al-Shabab wins the battle and the propaganda war. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin in Nairobi.